Metro Manila and several areas reporting COVID-19 surges back under lockdown. The Philippines detects over 100 more Delta variant cases. Walk-in COVID-19 vaccinations in Metro Manila suspended following the recent chaos in inoculation sites. We will tackle that with Senator Francis Tolentino. He's the chairman of the Senate Committee on Local Government. And the ruling PBB Laban Party leaning towards the Duterte tandem. We'll have a discussion on that, as well as the failed unification pitch of Senator Pangilo Lacson to Vice President Lenny Robredo with political analyst Tony Lavinia. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us. For those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad to have you with us today. Let's begin with this story. Metro Manila back on hard lockdown today. And just like in the past, enhanced community quarantines, motorists and essential workers are enduring heavy traffic at checkpoints. Our correspondent Jervis Manahan filed this report.
Tight security is being implemented here at the Batasan San Mateo checkpoint, which is the border of Quezon City and Rizal, because today is the first day of the enhanced community quarantine, also the third time of Metro Manila to be under the strictest form of lockdown. Motorists are already complaining because of the massive traffic this checkpoint has created. Some motorists say the tail end of the traffic is now at Montalvan, Rizal. The process of verifying whether the motorists are authorized people outside residents is quite slow. IDs and driver's licenses are being checked. Temperature isn't being checked anymore, and as long as passengers can provide enough proof that they are doing essential work, they will be allowed to pass. Traffic started building up as early as 4:30 a.m., but it's only worsening as the day progresses. There is a single lane for cars and another lane for motorcycles. Some motorists are saying this is such an inconvenience for them.
Marami po malilate nito panigurado sa trabaho. Dahil napakaba simula SM San Mateo hanggang dito. Grabe po yung traffic. Sinakop na po yung pangatlong lane doon para lang makausad yung ibang sasakyan.
Traffic, sir? Laba?
Mahaba pa traffic.
Oo.
Mula kanina,
hanggang sa Mateo.
Medyo inconvenient to hassle.
Hassle, medyo kundi.
Saan pa ang dulo ng traffic net nito?
Abot na hanggang Montalban.
Abot ng Montalban?
Oo, hanggang Marikina.
Earlier today, we have seen bikers and motorcycle riders who were denied entry to Quezon City because they weren't able to provide proof that they are doing essential work.
The Philippine Police Force will assess whether it will do away with checkpoints during the hard lockdown in Metro Manila following the heavy traffic at borders. Police Chief Guillermo Eleazar says the decision will be based on the number of violators caught until tomorrow.
Kung makita natin na lahat ng dumadaan dyan isa walang violators o walang nagpapalusot, might as well I will declare the remaining days of this quarantine. But the point is, if during this day and tomorrow, we will see a lot of motorists na nagbabiolate nito, ay wala tayong magagawa kung hindi mag-check tayo. Ang bilin natin sa ating mga unit commanders is kung talagang nagtutukod ng traffic, let it go. Release natin yan. And then after that, mag-random check-in tayo.
Aside from Metro Manila, more areas in the Philippines are now under stricter lockdowns due to rising COVID-19 cases. Laguna, Iloilo City, and Cagayan de Oro were placed under enhanced community quarantine until August 15th. A modified ECQ has been imposed on Cavite, Lucena City, Rizal, and Iloilo Province. Meanwhile, Batangas and Quezon Province have been placed under general community quarantine with heightened restrictions. As for Hingoog City in Misamis Oriental, it will return to GCQ with heightened restrictions on Sunday, August 8th, after a 1-week hard lockdown. Here's a refresher on ECQ rules from ABS-CBNNews.com. First off, residents would or should stay home. They can only go out for work or do grocery runs. Only essential workers can travel between cities, and they must observe the 8 p.m. to 4 a.m. curfew. Residents can jog and bike for exercise, but they must do it only within the village. Only virtual religious gatherings will be allowed. Business establishments like bars, internet cafes, and amusement parks are barred from operating. And lastly, COVID-19 vaccinations will still continue under ECQ. For more stories and breaking news, go to news.abs-cbn.com. Over 100 more cases of the highly contagious Delta variant detected in the Philippines. 116 new Delta infections were reported Thursday, raising the total to 331. Most of the cases are local transmissions. Metro Manila had the most number of new Delta cases with 83. Three patients are from Calabarzon, while Central Visayas recorded 4. Health authorities also found hundreds of or more cases of the Alpha and Beta variants. The Philippines logged over 8,000 new cases of COVID-19 Thursday. The number of active infections now at 66,895. This is the highest in 3 months. The country's positivity rate is at 17.3%. Nearly 200 new deaths were also reported, the highest in nearly 2 weeks. The Lung Center of the Philippines nearing full capacity as infections at the COVID-19 referral hospital increase. Hospital officials say 90% of COVID-19 beds and critical units are already occupied. That's significantly higher than the 40% to 50% occupancy rate in the past months.
We have noted that there's a shift between the type of patients that we're seeing. Previously, we're seeing patients that are of senior citizen, those with comorbidities. But now when we make our rounds, we are very alarmed that we see patients that are less than 40 years old, and some even don't have comorbidities. So as of the moment, we haven't reached our full capacity. But I think time will come that since we are dedicated with the severe and critical ones, we might be able to shy away the moderate ones.
Meanwhile, the East Avenue Medical Center in Quezon City says it is prepared for a potential surge in COVID-19 patients.
Kinokompleto namin yung additional ICU beds namin, additional 15 beds ito dun sa COVID building namin. And we hope that the project will be completed in 14 to 20 days. Nakipag-tie up kami sa isang private oxygen provider. No, right now, on board na sila, and in fact, nagde-deliver na sila ng oxygen tanks for stockpiling. So nakapag-stockpile na kami. No? And then meron kaming understanding na just in case na mag-surge, meron na kaming understanding yung delivery system na gagawin sa amin. May assured supply na kami from them.
And this just in from ABS-CBN News.com. DOH spokesperson Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergere says 16 out of 17 areas in Metro Manila have now recorded Delta variant cases. The spokesperson is yet to clarify which Metro Manila city has yet to record a Delta variant carrier. For more details of this, you can go to news.abs-cbn.com. Moving on, Philippine Justice Secretary Minardo Guevara admits the interagency task force against COVID-19 needs to improve how it communicates pandemic guidelines. Guevara made that comment following the chaos at vaccination sites in Manila, Las Piñas, and Antipolo. Tens of thousands of people rushed to get shots over fake reports. Those unvaccinated will not receive cash aid and will not be allowed to go out. Guevara says the IATF had already clarified it will not make a distinction between the unvaccinated and the vaccinated due to vaccine supply constraints. It was President Rodrigo Duterte who said last week, unvaccinated individuals will not be allowed to go out. But Malacanang blamed the chaos on fake information and local government units. The Metropolitan Manila Development Authority says there will temporarily be no walk-in vaccinations in the National Capital Region. This is to prevent a repeat of the chaos and confusion that happened at vaccination sites.
Kaya po, antayin na lang po ng ating mga kababayan ang kanilang notice po ng sa kanilang email o kaya po sa kanilang barangay kung kailan po at anong oras sila pwedeng pumunta sa kanilang vaccination sites. At huwag po tayong maniwala dun sa mga fake news na kumakalat.
Meanwhile, Manila Mayor Isko Moreno is seeing a coordinated attack on his city. He reveals the night before the chaos in vaccination sites in Manila, hackers tried to get into the city's website.
Maybe it's coincidence because the night before the chaotic situation in SM San Lazaro, supposed to be vaccination site, our website was attacked 133 times by hackers. But fortunately, with the help of some technological protection in protecting the data ng taong bayan. They failed.
I'm going to take a break now. Up ahead, it looks like a go for the PDP Laban's Go Duterte tandem will tackle the latest developments in the 2022 presidential elections and Dateline Philippines returns. Stay with us here on ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
You're still with Dateline Philippines here on ANC. Let's take another look at our headlines this noon. Metro Manila and several areas reporting COVID-19 surges back on hard lockdown. The Philippines detects over 100 more Delta variant cases. Walk-in COVID-19 vaccinations in Metro Manila suspended following the recent chaos in inoculation sites. And the ruling BDP Laban Party leaning towards the Go Duterte tandem. Still on our top story today, we're going to get the reaction now of Senator Francis Tolentino on the recent chaotic scenes at vaccination lines in some parts of Metro Manila. Senator Tolentino, of course, is the chairman of the Senate Committee on Local Government. Senator, good afternoon to you. Welcome to the program.
Good afternoon, Carmina. Good afternoon to your viewers as well.
All right. The pace of vaccination has been quite slow, but it did get a huge boost when the donated vaccines started to arrive. But then this happened. Take a look at this, Senator. This is what happened in Las Piñas yesterday. And in a few seconds, we'll be showing you what happened in the city of Manila. Thousands of people there, just throngs of people going to vaccination sites. This is very early in the morning yesterday. So, Senator, how would you describe the images that you just saw right now?
Positively, I would refer it as a reflection of the people's eagerness to be vaccinated, to be jabbed. So you're ruling out now hesitancy with the influx of But that crowd surge, I think it just shows that they want to get jab first and foremost. But Carmina, I don't want to have this generalized. There should be a differentiation between rural areas and the NCR, the metropolitan areas. And one mistake, and perhaps misinformation in one LGU cannot be equated generally to other LGUs or to the entire LGU specifically. So It's perhaps symptomatic of the eagerness of our countrymen to have their vaccines soon.
Mm. You said positively you see this as eagerness coming from the public right. To get vaccinated. Conversely, though, negatively, how would you describe this?
Perhaps in some areas, perhaps in the areas which the video showed, perhaps just in one barangay, we can state that perhaps misinformation or lack of a system for crowd control probably generated that situation. But it cannot be an overall picture of how the LGU is doing. Perhaps there was one mistake or there was a lack of credible information dissemination on how the jobs can be done systematically led to that. And Carmina, you should note that all of this happened before the declaration or the operationalization of the ECQ. So the misinformed probably thought that they cannot go out without the jab, they cannot go to the grocery stores, convenience stores without the vaccination. So we have to take this in totality, Carmina.
Yeah, but Senator, who should be held accountable for this?
I think it's not a reflection generally of lapses on the part of the LGUs. I would commend the LGUs. They've done a good job. I've been saying this ever since. pandemic is a global problem, but the solutions will be local. The solutions will be made by the mayors, the vice mayors, and the barangay captains. They've been there since day one. They've been manning the checkpoints. They've been conducting the lockdowns. They've been distributing the ayudas. They've been sacrificing. I have several friends, mayors who have died because of COVID. I will not mention them. But I commend them. But for this two instances, probably there can be an investigation. But it's not a general reflection on what the LGUs have done so far. They've been doing good. They've been excellent.
In fact, some experts or some of the observations have been that the LGUs have been overburdened.
Yes, lack of resources, overburdened. And I've been saying this, they should be part of the IATF. They should have a seat at the table. They should have a voice there. So we could have prevented what transpired in Cebu and other places. And secondly, I've been saying this since the last several months, there should be an overall picture or publication daily, not just of how many vaccinations were made, first dose, second dose, but the number of vaccines doses available. How many were delivered to a specific LGU, to a specific barangay, to a specific province? Wala tayong records na lumalabas even in the media. So I've been crying out for that. We should have a specific, for instance, Region 4A, how many were given to Santa Rosa, Laguna? How many were given to a specific barangay in Santa Rosa, Laguna?
So, and why is that important, Senator?
It is important because people would know that, for instance, in our barangay, the available vaccines are just 50 for a population of 1,500, and we have to prioritize the senior citizens and those with comorbidities. So it is important because in terms of queuing, in terms of placing all the systems in place, you have the universe of available vaccines known by the people themselves. So it is important. Ito lang yung available. Huwag tayong magagawan. It is the foundation of how discipline and the correct LGU systems can be put in place. Without that, magulo talaga. Akala nila all can be vaccinated. That's why we have that situation.
Let's go back to the misinformation that spread, Senator Tolentino. Mayor Isko Moreno also reporting earlier today that there were reports in the city of Manila of vehicles dropping off loads of people in the vaccination sites. What do you make of that? If we were to trace back what actually happened here, you said there might be an investigation. So if there will be an investigation, what are the questions you think that should be answered?
I'm not so familiar with the exact situation in the city of Manila. I'm no longer MMDA chairman, but I think it is not a reflection of the entire 1,200 municipalities of the Philippines. It is not a reflection of the entire 82 or 83 provinces of the Philippines. So one situation can probably be explained. Let the LGU head explain what transpired. But it should not be equated into a hasty generalization, which would conclude that all LGUs are flawed. All the LGU systems are flawed. They're doing good. Without them, we could have been in a worse situation, Carmina.
Okay, so but then we also know that the president, I think it was a couple of weeks ago, when the president, Mr. Senator, said something like, ito ngayong ayaw magpabahuna, sinasabi ko sa inyo, huwag kayong lumabas ng bahay ninyo, kasi kapag lumabas ng kayo ng bahay, sabihin ko sa mga police, e ibalik kayo doon sa bahay mo. I mean, there were reports also yesterday, Senator, that this was also a factor, maybe, that people got scared. Also, because as you correctly pointed out, it was on the eve of the operationalization of the ECQ. Do you think that also was a factor in the mayhem that we saw yesterday?
If you aggregate all of this, it boils down to the number of vaccines available in our inventory right now. So that's why I've been egging the IAT at DOH, ilabas nyo how many vaccines. Moderna donated 3 million. J&J donated 3 million two weeks ago. So how many were distributed to the barn, to Region 8, to other areas where there is a perceived surge in Delta variants? So how many will be distributed to the ECQ areas? Yeah, MECQ area. So we have to be transparent on this. So the news reports, no offense, or the statements coming from the leadership or even from other sources probably help put up a sense of urgency on the part of household members that they should be vaccinated and be a cause for worry. But again, LGUs will be at the forefront, first frontliner or last frontliner. They should not be blamed. They should be commended. 98% or 99% of them are performing well beyond the call of duty. I've seen this. I've been going around. Some mayors, as I mentioned a while ago, even died because of COVID. How can you explain to your population that you just got 300 doses if your population is 20,000? It's not been reported in the media. These are sacrifices being made by the LGU. So I look at it in not just a sense of urgency on the part of the residents to be jabbed, but we should learn something from this, Carmina. I foresee in the future that now COMELEC should also learn from this. I foresee long lines during election day. I foresee long lines come September 30, which is the last day for registration. So these are symptoms of what would happen. So we have to learn a lot from this rather than blame each other and look forward to a more reasonable implementation of appropriate systems for the LGUs, including crowd control. Carmina.
Yun ang nga rin eh. Some are saying, Senator, you know, that these people did not just magically appear in 1 second, right? There was, you can track it, that slowly people started to gather, slowly people started to arrive. There should have been one point there where marshals should have been deployed. What do you think about that?
I'm not so familiar, again, I reiterate what I mentioned a while ago. I'm not so familiar, again, with the systems employed in Manila, for instance, if you're zeroing on Manila. Perhaps the good mayor could have placed some systems there. Who knows? But for the rest of the country, this is not a prevailing situation. There are more disciplined areas which you can be proud of. Queuing, falling in line. So at the outset, I mentioned there should be a differentiation between rural and urban areas. There should be a distinction between the density, the population, the urban sprawl. Different systems would have to be employed and methods deployed.
Moving forward, Senator Tolentino, this is not going to be the last pandemic that the whole world will face. Experts have said that. So in terms of looking at that, what possible legislation do you have in mind to further strengthen the LGUs so that they're more capable, they won't be as vulnerable if the next pandemic comes, Senator?
If you're referring to the next variant, that would be the Lambda variant, Carmina. But I'm looking at upgrading the powers of the local health boards. Again, these are local solutions. The mayors should be given, the local health boards, the mayors, the chairman should be given more resources. And with the forthcoming application of the Mandanas ruling, where they would get a windfall of, I think, more than 27 billion pesos, I think they will have enough resources, Carmina. And again, looking from the lessons, I think LGUs should be allowed to purchase their own vaccines. Rather than going through a tripartite agreement. Looking forward, Carmina, if this will last by September, I've heard that the US FDA will approve Pfizer, not just for an EUA, but full approval. That meaning to say, it's available to the private sector, it's available to local government units. So these are good windows for our LGUs as well, for them to purchase directly rather than rely on the mechanisms being employed right now. Tingi yon depende sa reports kung saan mas maraming infected, but upgrading the local health boards, giving them the necessary wherewithal to purchase equipment, I think would be a step in the right direction in terms of legislative reforms, Carmina.
So now, looking back, Senator, would you say that these tripartite agreements were more of a stumbling block in the COVID response?
The reason probably given is that it was just EUA. That was what they were telling me. But freeing, unlocking the resources of the private sector, the companies, and LGUs with enough resources would probably provided us with more vaccines. Some LGUs, I've been saying before, have sister cityhood relationships with San Francisco, Los Angeles, et cetera, et cetera. And excess vaccines can be given to sister LGUs. And some private companies with multinational link-ups can also purchase for their employees. So we open up the economies ahead rather than wait for the distribution of the tripartite purchased vaccine. But it's good. Nasimula na yun eh.
But are you going to at all? Are you going to push for this once, the full authorization is given to whichever vaccine, and it's not just under an EUA? Is this
yes? Okay, definitely. The top 10 companies, the top 100 companies can purchase directly. They should be able to purchase directly with the help of the Department of Foreign Affairs.
Kasi alam mo, Senator, I've been talking to a lot of our local chief executives, and each time they would say it all depends on the vaccines that will be allotted to them.
That's why I was asking that this be published. How many were allotted to Iloilo, to Cagayan de Oro, to Santa Rosa Laguna, to Cavite, etc., etc.?
So parang depende talaga, and that has really affected the momentum. Not, yes. Of course, there is a shortage of supply,
yes,
right?
Because
that's also
what we've been publishing so far are the number of jobs made, the number of infected persons per area, but not the number of vaccines distributed. But again, we cannot fault IATF. This is the first time we've had this. We cannot fault the LGUs. They've been doing an excellent job, and they should continue with that.
Final
faults and flaws.
Final question on this point. Senator Tolentino, you said that the mayor should have a seat at, in the IATF. Should that be worked on
not
now?
All of them.
Sorry, go ahead. You were saying, why not? Why wait for the next pandemic? Why not give them a seat right here, right now?
Yes. I've been advocating for that. Not just the LGUs, but the private sector, the Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry. Mm-hmm. They should have a seat at the IATF.
Where's
not
the
just a subcommittee, but the main committee.
Yeah, where's the resistance coming from?
I don't know yet. I've written IATF a letter. I've filed a resolution on this. No resistance. Probably it's an ongoing execution of policies that should not be hindered by amendments to policies. So hintayin na lang natin. But so far, again, I reiterate for the nth time, I'm satisfied for the excellent job being made, the sacrifices being made by our LGUs. Nationwide, okay. Not just the Metro Manila, but even the rural areas.
Does that satisfaction, I'm going to shift topics now before we let you go, Senator Tolentino. Does that satisfaction, can you say that that's the same satisfaction that you have when it was announced last night that there has been a tandem that's been endorsed in the ruling party, which you're a part of, and that's the Go Duterte tandem? What do you make of it? What are your thoughts on it?
Well, it's a party decision. It will have to be decided by the party, and as a party member, I would abide by party decision. But I think these are just anecdotal media reports coming out from various sources. I think it will have to be decided by a party convention forthcoming, and we have to await that, Carmina. But as a party member, I respect whatever decision would be forthcoming, Carmina.
So based on your principles and your values, is this a tandem that you would fully support?
Again, I reiterate my compliance with party rules and regulations, Carmina.
They're also saying that this tandem was thought of for continuity, but Senator, can it also be seen as a failure to deliver the campaign promises that they need more time to fulfill these?
Well, I cannot speak for the tandem's supposed to be next platform, but I just reiterate my support based on party support. So I cannot go beyond that, Carmina. It will have to be advocated by the party itself, Carmina.
Okay, we're going to have to leave it at that. Senator Francis Tolentino, their chairman of the Senate Committee on Local Government, thanks so much for joining us this afternoon.
Take care. Keep safe. Thank you.
Right, moving on. Another quarantine checkpoint, this time along Marcos Highway, also causing traffic buildup. Our correspondent, Ara Perez, now joins us for an update. Ara, go ahead.
Carmina, there are still long lines of vehicles at the checkpoint in Marikina in Marcos Highway here in Marikina going to Quezon City. Motorists are already aware of what to do. Before reaching the checkpoint, some are preparing their IDs while others are already holding on to them. I spoke with some motorcycle riders and they said checkpoints are really hassle for them. But unlike previous strict lockdowns, this time their waiting time isn't that long. A factor would be the policemen simultaneously checking IDs, even going at the back of the line of motorists, so that those who have shown their IDs may already proceed with their trip. So far, I have not seen a vehicle being issued with a violation. Policemen just mainly ask about the purpose of travel or simply their IDs. They also check those of private vehicles and GTs. This checkpoint is still causing traffic buildup, but motorists do not stay idle for a long time. Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Ara. Take care and you keep safe. Moving on, the Department of Interior and Local Government withdraws a show cause order issued to Manila Mayor Isko Moreno. The order had directed him to explain why he shouldn't be held administratively liable for the city's alleged failure to implement the war on drugs in 2018. Here's the thing, though. Moreno only took office in 2019. In a new memorandum, DILG Interior Undersecretary RICO Judge Echeverri acknowledged that they had mistakenly reissued an earlier show cause order transmitted in 2019. Moreno, a possible presidential contender in the 2022 poll, says he already responded to the DILG the first time. But now that it has happened again, here's what he had to say.
They can do what they want to do. I'm busy attending to the COVID-19. They can parliament charges if they want to. Who will hinder them? I still continue to believe that there is a democracy in this country.
Senator Bongo and President Rodrigo Duterte will likely be the PDP-Laban Party's presidential and vice presidential candidates next year. The ruling party's president, Alfonso Cusi, confirmed members agreed to endorse the Go-Duterte tandem. Secretary General Melvin Matibag also mentioned this Thursday as he talked about the result of their National Executive Council meeting this week. Matibag, however, says they have yet to finalize their lineup. The party is set to have a national assembly on September 8th. Senator Bongo, a longtime aide of President Duterte, thanked his supporters in the party.
Marahil ito ang nakikita ng partido na tandem para may pagpatuloy ang mga magagandang pagbabago na nasimulan ng Administrasyong Duterte. Uulitin ko, kung tatanungin niyo ako muli, pareho rin ang isasagot ko sa inyo. I am not interested, gaya ng sinabi ko noon. Ang makapagbabago lang ng aking desisyon na tumakbo bilang presidente ay kung si Tatay Digong ang aking magiging vice presidente. Dahil alam ko, yun ang magiging totoong continuity.
Along the 2022 elections, presidential aspirant Senator Panfilo Lacson on Thursday revealed Vice President Lenny Robredo turned down his offer of a unified front against the administration. Let's tackle that, as well as other key developments on the 2022 presidential race with political analyst Professor Tony Lavinia. He is, of course, former dean of the Ateneo School of Government. Professor Tony, thank you for joining us today. Nice to see you.
Hello, Carmina. Nice to see you after a while.
I know. How are you? Have you been doing?
I'm okay. It could be better, I think, for all of us. But, surviving. This will end. I know that. So just have to do the work from home for now.
All right. So let's begin our discussion. What do you make of this unification formula? What are your thoughts on that?
First of all, I don't know what that unification formula, because that was not publicly revealed by Senator Lacson. I suppose it would be about polling and who will be in the lead between the two of them. It seems to me this is just a formula for Lacson and Robredo. It's not even a formula that includes other potential opposition candidates like Mayor Isko Moreno or Senator Manny Pacquiao. I mean, so, or Senator Trillanes. So I suppose that would be about who's has the lead in the poll at some point or another. I wish it were about platform, because that's really the best way to unify people, if they can agree on a platform, because then it doesn't matter who's going to run. I suppose, Carmina, it's too early to have a unified candidate, whether for the Duterte camp. Very interesting what you just said, right? I mean, that it's Bongo and Duterte for PDP Laban, because we know that Sara Duterte is going to be for Hugpong, HNP, and maybe Romualdez or Gilbert Chodoro, Marcos for VP, or Marcos himself might also run. So there's a consolidation process for all the different factions. Speaker Cayetano is also saying he will run. So we need to find the method in the madness here.
Yeah,
I actually think we can find that at some point.
I want to go back to what you earlier said. You don't know what was stated in that unification formula. Nobody knows, right? Do you think that the narrative that it be made public, so that we may know where both stand, why there was a resistance, and why it was rejected, Professor?
No, exactly. It would be nice to do that. What's happening now is the public, we're not in the loop in how the politicians are making the decisions. So in a way, it's so untransparent. It would be nice if they both agreed to actually disclose it publicly, so we can all have a say and either push the unification or actually say, well, then in that case, there's really no need to have a unification process.
Because as it stands, what kind of an impression do you think that left the public? That there was an offer made and there was a rejection, there was a resistance to that offer.
Exactly. I think to some extent it left VP Robredo in a bind, right? In a negative light, because she was the one that rejected it. But knowing her, she will one day talk about that, I think. VP Robredo has been very systematic about her decision-making process here. Sooner or later, we will know whether she will run or not. She's actually said that she wants a united opposition. And so that probably is going to be the basis for her decision. Which candidate can unify most of the opposition? And so that's why she's talking to a lot of people.
You say that she's been systematic, while some have observed that she's been too systematic to a fault. What do you say to that?
Well, I think it is very clear about what she's looking at, which is that whether she will win or not, whether in fact she has a chance of winning, or it's better for someone else to run, and she will give the support, her support, to that someone else so that can win against a Duterte candidate. That is as systematic as you can be, and she's moving around and asking that question. So I mean, I don't know what answer she is being given, but eventually we will all know. I mean, I would say within a month, probably either in August or September, we'll soon know soon enough. So we just have to be patient with that. I mean,
if that happens, though, Professor Tony, if that happens, that she decides not to run and just endorses a person she feels has a better chance at winning, do you think that the support that she has now will be easily transferable to whoever she chooses?
Not necessarily, but if people see that's the best chance, because her core support is really an anti-Duterte constituency. But if they see that, in fact, there's someone that can defeat a Duterte candidate, then that could transfer. I mean, unlike, for example, a Moreno candidacy or a Grace Poe candidacy, which she said she will no longer do, that is not easily transferable to Lenny, for example, to VP Lenny, because it's a popular vote. It's a popular choice, right? Well, for example, I think Grace Poe and Moreno can easily transfer their votes to each other as a popularity thing. I mean, even Pacquiao's vote would be a popular vote rather than an anti-Duterte or a vote for a particular platform of government. And so I think, to be honest, and I've said this in writing as well, VP Lenny deciding not to run is more courageous than running, in the sense that if she does that, she will disappoint. If she does not run, she will disappoint her supporters. While if she runs, she will keep them, even if in the end, ultimately, she will lose. I mean, so that for me, that's a very important question to ask. Can you actually win in the elections? Because mm-hmm. why would you? And it's not about her, as she said. It's about whether or not I will doom the chance of someone else to win against a Duterte candidate if I run. That's how she frames it.
Yeah, but do you think though that if she decides not to run, aside from the disappointment that her supporters would feel, do you think that her supporters, if that happens, will be forced to compromise their
belief? If there is an opposition candidate, so for example, if you've been watching, well, you just actually had Mayor Moreno in, right? So Mayor Moreno has been, over the last few days, very consistent about putting himself in the opposition camp. Unlike Senator Lacson and Senator Soto, who's saying that they're in between, they're not, or even Senator Pacquiao, no? I mean, they're not certainly criticizing President Duterte, but Mayor Moreno has been very consistent about that already. I'm sure there are some supporters of VP Lenny that still, call them purists, in the sense that they do not trust anyone else other than someone coming from the camp. I mean, of the Liberal Party. They some of them will still, but I think if they see that it's an opposition candidate, they'd probably move. I mean, so the way I see is that on one side you have the Dutertes, the father and the daughter, needing to consolidate. Marcos needing to consolidate as well with them, or go separately. Pacquiao will probably go on his own. I don't know if he will move to the opposition. But the opposition, you actually have, you can have Grace Poe, Isko Moreno, and VP Lenny's voters come together actually in a candidate that's mutually acceptable. And mm-hmm. right now that seems to be Mayor Moreno, but in politics, a day is long, right? I mean, you can have a surprise the next day. So that's also not a fearless forecast that I can make publicly made.
Meanwhile, Professor Tony, PDP Laban, formally endorsing the tandem of Senator Bongo and President Duterte as his running mate for VP, what do you make of that?
Well, that's a play, actually, to force, compel, persuade Sara Duterte to agree to his father being his VP. Because, and I don't know anything other than my own analysis, but having seen the father-daughter through the years, also as mayor and vice mayor, the daughter has her own mind. Let's be clear about that. And probably would not want her father to be his vice president, her vice president. I mean, so let's really apply for that. Now, what if the daughter in fact says no, right? Mm-hmm. Then that's not going to be a tenable candidacy, both of them, because they're going to divide the votes, the Duterte votes, very easily. So one has to give. Either Sara Duterte walks out and say, okay, kayo na lang, or the president gives up his desire to become vice president, which is just a way of protecting himself personally. So that's how I see it. People say that eventually, you know, family being family, they'll be able to settle it among themselves, and maybe you can even get the Duterte tandem, in which case the president gets prevails over the desire of the daughter, or the daughter might just get his way, because it's hard to see how Senator Bongo would be a feasible candidate, viable.
Why do you
candidate,
say that? You know? Why do you say that?
Well, the votes are not there for now, no, but people do not see him as a presidential candidate right now. Mm-hmm. He doesn't seem to have the votes. He will have the machinery, mm-hmm. But in our presidential elections, the machinery does not matter as much as your personality and the campaign that you follow, right? So that's what we need to see. So you either going to have the choices that will come out of that is going to be go Duterte, Sara Duterte, and someone else like Romualdez or Chidoro, mm-hmm. Or someone else that she prefers, or it will be a Duterte. But sooner or later, we'll also find that out. I mean, and that would have to go against, hopefully, an opposition, a unified opposition, but with still Pacquiao and Lacson running on their own. So eventually, okay. The hope is to have four candidates at most. Hmm. And then that would be very interesting on how the regions would divide and on how.
Let me just cut you there, Professor Lavina. Do you think that if it's going to be a four-way race or even more, do you think that that would benefit the public eventually?
I think so, actually. I think that the more choices we have, the better it is for us. I mean, that's always been the case. Eventually, anyway, people do settle on their first choice. And others would just drop out of the race. I mean,
all right. Going back to the,
we don't have the problem, Carmina, is we don't have primaries, we don't have political conventions. We need to see the candidates, no? So we actually need to see how they campaign, how they what their vision is. That's good. And then someone drops out, or someone clearly we will see is not able to campaign well and get their vision across. We've seen that BP Binay, Senator Villar, they all dropped out in the end.
Professor, going back to the Go Duterte tandem, you know, when it was announced, they said that it speaks of continuity. But how would you call it? How would you describe it?
I call it just the president, the current president, wanting to stay in power. I actually think in spirit it violates the Constitution. It's likely that, in fact, you know, if the tandem wins, it's not out of the question that the Senator Go would resign to let the president take over. That's not unlikely. That's not gonna happen for sure with Sara Duterte. She will not resign in favor of her father. Because as I said, she has her own mind. I mean, I don't necessarily favor her because I think in terms of governance, she will govern the same way as the father, especially with the issues I care about, like human rights. But she's definitely not, not follow her father all the time. We've seen that when she was mayor of Davao, and we know the way she governs Davao now, she doesn't really ask his father what to do. But Senator Go was very clear about that, even in your clip. I will run for president if he's the vice president, because that's the real continuity.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And they might campaign that way. They might actually campaign in saying that a vote for me is a vote for Duterte back as president. And unfortunately, there's actually nothing in the law that prevents that. Nothing in the Constitution that prevents that. It's against the spirit of the Constitution. But I can pretty much say that constitutionally, in terms of constitutional text, and most probably the Supreme Court will allow something like that, because there's nothing in the Constitution that says that a previous president who becomes vice president can no longer become president. Nothing like that.
Okay, we're going to have to leave it at that. I wish we had more time. Professor Tony Lavinia there, former dean of the Ateneo School of Government. Appreciate you coming to the show. Thanks again. Continue to keep safe and you take care.
You too, Carmina. Thank you.
Thanks. Appreciate it. And that'll do it for today. Thank you for joining us, keeping us company the whole week this week. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcasts. Playback this newscast too on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it to you on ANC.
At a time when we are gripped by fear, we are inspired by your courage. At a time when we are in dire need of hope, we look up to your sense of duty and compassion. At a time when the default reaction is self-preservation, you put the needs of the sick above your own. All those who are in the front lines of this pandemic, thank you.